Hey, I'm Dee Grant Smith, the Relationship Growth Farmer, and I help people grow love and success from within by cultivating your heart and your mind garden. Now, I've been doing this series of videos on Neville Goddard's teachings on the law of assumption, and I'm going to take this into a new field or a new area, something that I'm very passionate about, but I honestly haven't really shared anything about, not at least in videos like this before, and that is an affinity I have for sports, and not necessarily current sports. I'm somebody that, I don't know if you want to call it living in the past necessarily, but I'm a big fan of some of my sports heroes from the 1980s and 1990s. And what I want to do today is showcase to you different heroes of mine who have been facilitating, or who did facilitate back in their prime, aspects of these teachings that I've been sharing with you from Neville Goddard, particularly the law of assumption and persistence until it hardens into fact. Now, what I'm going to do today is show you how all of us are using this law of assumption, but give you a very pinnacle illustration so that you can say, oh, there's more to it, and there's more to this greatness of this person than just their athletic ability. Now, the person I'm going to begin with is one of my all-time favorite sports heroes, Michael Jordan. Now, we could get into a conversation. I'm not going to call it a debate, because ultimately opinions clashing against each other is really just a conversation, and something that would be really fun to have. So if you want to have that, message me, hit me up, we can have this conversation. But I consider Michael Jordan to be the all-time greatest basketball player. Now, yes, LeBron James is awesome, and he's won all kinds of stuff, and he's a powerhouse in all these different ways. But I honestly don't watch much basketball now. Maybe if I did, I'd have a different opinion. But Michael Jordan is one of my favorite sports heroes, and in my opinion, he is the greatest basketball player of all time. He broke every record that was in front of him, and he led the same team with different players at different times to the NBA championship, and he won 6 times. Now, here's where I want to talk about how it's not just Michael Jordan's physical abilities, because that was always, and that usually is, what comes up in conversation when we think about the greatest sports character or sports person or sports hero. We look at just their physical abilities. And what that often does for us as non-sports people or non-athletic people — I'm not a super athlete, I'm a really skinny guy that's always been skinny my whole life. And I used to marginalize and take myself out of the picture, because I would look at my body and make assumptions about my worth and assumptions about my abilities based on what I perceive to be about my body. Have you done that? If you have, you're not alone. Here's the thing that made Michael Jordan great. Yes, he had an incredible body that he worked out all the time, and he was consistently working on improving in his physical skills. But where Michael Jordan was actually adopting Neville Goddard's law of assumption was what he entertained in his mind. And his persistence in this entertainment inside his mind, persistence in belief in the wish fulfilled, dwelling in the wish fulfilled and persisting regardless of what he experienced and what resistance he experienced in his life, persisting in the wish fulfilled over and over and over again is what created this incredible, successful, iconic sports person. Now, I've got a couple notes here because I decided to actually do a little bit of research instead of just quoting a bunch of things that I didn't necessarily know to be factually accurate. Every single athlete that has ever been successful in anything, whether it's basketball with making shots or taking shots, baseball with batting averages and home runs, or football, American football, with running or passing or throwing or whatever, there's shots that are taken, there's passes that are thrown, there are runs that are made, there are, or look at golf, shots that are taken there, putts that are taken. There are missed shots. There are missed opportunities. All of us face challenges and missed opportunities. We try for something, it doesn't work the way that we want it to the first time, so what do we tell ourselves? What story do we sit in? What assumption do we make about who we are based on what we don't get perfect? The icons don't sit in their failures. They stay focused on their wish. They stay focused on their vision. They stay focused on what it is that they want, and they persist in that vision, in their mind, and they tell themselves that every single next opportunity is going to be successful. They sit in their wish fulfilled. They're practicing Neville Goddard's law of assumption. Whether they are aware of it or not, it doesn't matter because it's still a law. Now, did Neville create the law of assumption? No, but he helped bring it into the awareness of the consciousness of all of us. And he did so, for the most part, 80 something years ago. His teachings and stuff are very, very old, but they're still very, very true because it's still a law of the universe. The law of assumption says that what you believe to be true and what you imagine inside yourself to be what you're going to experience and what you choose to believe and choose to assume is what is actually going to happen in your life. It's what I talk about with growth farming. Whatever seeds you're planting inside your mind with your thoughts and your beliefs and your ideas is what you're going to produce with your life, with your actions, attitudes, and behaviors, and the responses of other people. If you assume somebody's evil and assume the worst about their character, you're going to experience the worst about their character. If you assume the best in people, you're going to experience the best in people. Now, are there exceptions to this? Sure. Are there exceptions where you believe in the best in somebody and they hurt you? And so then you're thinking, well, D. Grant, I've been through absolute hell in this relationship and I believed in the best in this person and they showed me this darkness and this rejection and they treated me like crap. So this law of assumption thing must be absolute garbage. No. Yes, you might have assumed something about somebody else, but what was the utter assumption about yourself? What was the utter assumption, the real truthful assumption about who you are, ignoring their behaviors and ignoring their patterns and ignoring their treatment of you? What did you believe about yourself? Were you giving and believing out of this neediness and out of this invalidation and out of this codependency, people pleasing? Or did you believe in the best in yourself? Now, where does this meet with Michael Jordan and his success? Michael Jordan took over three, he took tons of shots. He missed, I've got it written down here, he missed over 9,000 shots in his career. He's considered one of the greatest basketball players of all time. Again, I consider him to be the greatest basketball player of all time. He made 25 game-winning shots. He was 5-for-11 in the last 5 seconds of games of game-winning shots. But guess what? He also missed 26 game-winning shots. He missed 9,000 shots. Did he change the story about who he is and his potential? Did he change the story about his greatness in here and in here based on the missed shots, based on the game-winning shots, potential game-winning shots that he took, that he missed? No, he stayed persistent in the wish fulfilled, the wish fulfilled that he was the greatest basketball player that had ever lived. And so he put himself in his practice time in front of the free throw line, taking shot after shot after shot after shot and imagining it being the last 5 seconds and getting into that mental place where he was envisioning his wish fulfilled, and he did it over and over and over and over and over again. And he persisted in real time in game-winning situations where the ball is going to get put in his hands because he's the most confident, most skilled player out there. He made himself that way. He cultivated the garden from within. And he produced the fruit of that over and over and over again. And even when he failed, he didn't sit in his failure and say, this is now my story. He got back into the place of, I am the greatest. I am the greatest. I am the greatest. And that was his persistent belief and assumption about who he is. He operated from the law of assumption, and that greatness personified itself through his life and through his work and through his game-winning mentality. Now, you might not remember this if you weren't around in the early 90s or early to mid 90s, and you've seen Michael Jordan's name, or you're like, oh yeah, that guy from the past, whatever. Michael Jordan pressed pause on his basketball career in the mid 90s because he believed he could play professional baseball. Now, I'm from Birmingham, Alabama. I went and watched the Birmingham Barons play baseball when I was a little kid, and then I moved to Houston. And after I moved to Houston, that's when Michael Jordan decided he wanted to play professional baseball. And he got signed to a double A team. I think the Barons were a double A team. So where did he go play baseball? In Birmingham. I miss watching Michael Jordan play baseball, play minor league baseball by all of like 4 years because of the time that I had moved from. there was also a potential. I just read an article about this. There was also could have been a potential for Michael Jordan and Bo Jackson. I'm going to make a video about in the next, that'll be the subject of my next video, also tied into this law of assumption. Jordan and Jackson could have played on the same team for the Chicago White Sox. Didn't happen, but whatever. Michael Jordan played baseball professionally without playing for a major league team, but he still played baseball professionally for 13 months. Now, it's speculated that if he would have stayed in baseball, he would have played major league baseball. His belief in his absolute pinnacle awesomeness as an athlete allowed him to go from having zero college baseball experience. He played baseball in high school. Fast forward in time 10 or 12 years, and now he's playing for a AA professional team with zero baseball experience professionally. That's incredible athletic prowess. Now, yes, it was a physical prowess that he had, but it was also in here. Because guess what? He played on teams with guys that had incredible physical prowess that had been working and practicing and working and practicing over and over and over again for years. And he jumps ahead of the curve, and he's playing double-A baseball for 13 months. And then he decides, you know what? I'm going to go back and play basketball. Now, most people who press pause on their professional careers and go do something else, when they try to come back, they're not the same. They don't have that same sort of high-level dedication and focus and intensity and persistence and confidence. And they don't also have the same skills. So if you watch a lot of athletes that will retire briefly and then come back, when they come back usually as kind of a second-tier version of themselves. There are exceptions, of course. But for the most part, if you press pause on your career and you go do something else and you come back, you're not coming back as the same champion person that you were before you left. Michael Jordan came back to basketball, joined the Chicago Bulls again, and then won another NBA championship. Now, yes, he didn't finish his career as a Chicago Bull. He finished his career, I think, as a Washington Wizard, and he was off and on pretty good. He still had that diehard, I believe in myself mentality. He carried that all the way to retirement. But Michael Jordan was somebody that lived out this principle. He lived out the principle of the law of assumption. He assumed that he was champion. He assumed that he was the best. And he put in the work every single day, putting himself in situations in his training, in his physical training, where he was working on his body, and he was working on his shot, but he was also working on his mind. He was working on his heart, and he was working on his beliefs. And he chose to sit in the wish fulfilled. The wish fulfilled is, I am the greatest basketball player that's ever lived. I'm better than everybody else out there. I see that as myself. And regardless of what I experience, whether I hit every single shot or I miss every single shot, this is what I choose to believe. So one of the teachers that I follow on YouTube is a fantastic lady named Kim Velez. And she teaches a lot of this Neville Goddard stuff too. And she really focuses on persistence until the assumption becomes a hardened fact. Most of us don't persist. Most of us stop the perseverance process of what it is that we want to manifest into our lives or what it is that we want to attract into our lives when we start meeting with resistance, when we start feeling something other than what we want to experience. If we are trying to grow our business, but we're meeting with resistance and it's not coming easy, or we're trying all these tactics to market ourselves and put ourselves out there, and we're not getting the response that we want, instead of persisting and sitting in that place where we choose to believe what it is that we want is happening, what it is that we want is coming to us, and we assume that it is done. That's what amen means. Let it be. It is done. The prayer of the faithful is, this is my imagination. This is what I want to experience. I'm going to get into this place where I envision it and I experience it in my mind, and then my assumption is it's done. I don't have to go seek after it. I don't have to figure out how to make it happen. I focus on the what it is and the why. The why is I want it, and the what is whatever it is. God's gonna make the how happen, and God's gonna make the when happen, but I'm going to choose to believe that it is done. Michael Jordan did that in his professional career, over and over and over and over and over and over and over again. We can do that in our professional careers. Yes. We can do that in our personal lives. Yes. We can do that in our relationships. Yes. We can do that in every aspect of our lives. And I wanted to talk about Neville Goddard's law of assumption. I want to talk about this in light of what growth farming is in terms of us choosing to believe differently about ourselves, us choosing to think differently about ourselves, and us choosing to plant within us the seeds of success, the imagination, the creation from within of success, whatever that success is for you. And sitting in that and persisting in that, and regardless of what you experience outside of you in your 3D reality, whatever it is that's going on, you don't focus on that stuff. You let that be a sign and an indication of, okay, I am going to continue to believe in what I want. I'm going to choose to believe that what I want is coming into being and that I can have it because I'm worthy of it. And I get what I want. And I love myself. And I love myself and I love myself and I love myself. And every single time you're doing that, you're planting those seeds of love and success inside yourself. You're changing your thoughts and your beliefs and your ideas about who you are, what you're capable of, and what you're going to experience. And then guess what? That's what you experience. That's why it's a law of assumption. When you assume the wish fulfilled and you persist in that assumption, that's what shows up. Look at your life. If things aren't the way that you want it to be, look at your assumptions. Look at your thoughts and look at your beliefs. And when you meet against something that goes against what you actually want to experience, if you're going to sit in the opposite of what you want, is that what you experienced? My guess is, So how do you change that? You go within and you affirm to yourself with feeling. You imagine yourself living in the life that you want to experience. You imagine the things that you want to experience coming into your being. You imagine how that makes you feel. You go into that place where that is your reality from within. And you're planting those seeds, you're cultivating those seeds, you're growing and sowing those seeds. And then all seeds take root and they all produce a harvest. If you're going to sow love, that's what you're going to experience. If you're going to sow success, that's what you're going to experience. If you're going to sow doubt and fear and worry, that's what you're going to experience. The choice is yours. I believe in you. If you want some help in your journey and making this a reality for you, I've got all sorts of resources linked below that will help you grow in confidence, help you overcome whatever challenge you've been through, help you see yourself in a different way, help you growth farm love and success in every area of your life. I'm here for you. I love you. I believe in you, and I'll see you soon.